So I had a nice contract offer from the publisher, and I said, here's the condition. I said, if I find out that that plane went up and bad things happened, just an accident, I got to write that. I can't write some conspiracy book if it's not true. So they said, fine. They consented to that. So what I focused on was why the plane went up. And then I just uncovered this enormously corrupt enterprise in which, what made this work, and I've done this in virtually every book I've written, is find someone on the inside, a truth teller on the inside who wants to tell their story. And that's where I work with the Sanders on the Flight 800 book, and I work with Nalanda Butler Hill on the Ron Brown book. She was Brown's confidant, lover, mistress, and business partner. Fantastic, interesting lady, Texan. She's white, by the way, and she's just really, I've really stayed in touch with her. She's very spiritual, and she had some rough patches in her life, where she admits it, but she was deeply attached to Ron Brown. And not only was she attached to him emotionally, but she was attached to him business-wise, because she knew where all the bodies were buried. She knew everything that Ron Brown did. And so once his plane went down, then her life was at risk. Her life was at risk before the plane went down. She went into hiding for a couple years, they finally caught her. They prosecuted her on some bogus tax charge. Eric Holder, by the way, leading the way, and who was a Brown confidant. So that was my conditions for going into it. And then, just to tell you, the revealing moment. I also worked with another great truth teller in the book. They were my twin heroines of the book. The other one was Kathleen Janoski. She was a forensic photographer for the Armed Force Institute of Pathology. She was in the Navy also. And she was the one who discovered the hole in Ron Brown's head during the autopsy. There was no autopsy. When the bodies were coming back to Dover and she was photographed, and there were a couple of pathologists there. And as a result of her discovery of that hole, her career and the career of three pathologists were ruined because they went public with the information they had. There was no autopsy.
Did they do the x-ray of the head?
They did an x-ray of the head, and they had what they called the classic lead snowstorm. That is the bullet fragments in the head, and that was destroyed.
I have a copy.
you may have the last one. You don't have the hard copy because that's gone.
No.
You've seen the images.
Yeah, right.
Anyhow, that was... what intrigued me most, it's going to give you one intriguing detail. You really have to read the book because it's so much corruption. It was the two most corrupt years in American history, 95 and 96. Because after 94, when they had the House and the Senate, the Clintons led the most desperate ever campaign to retain the White House. And they were going to China for their money and Indonesia for their money. And Ron Brown was the bag man, and he didn't like being in that role. But he was so corrupt, it had so much on him. The Clintons did, all they had to do was drop him, and he was toast. And Dan was right, he was facing the Inquisition within a week or two of the plane crash. He didn't want to go to college. Here's the thing, that the revealing thing. Sometimes the revealing thing is what isn't there. For instance, in TWA Flight 800, Bill Clinton writes a 900-page book. TWA Flight 800 was considered the number one news story of 1996. It almost led to war. Several people had said to that, including Clinton himself, when he was interviewed by Taylor Branch. And of his 900 pages, he dedicates one paragraph to the whole incident. Hillary Clinton, in her autobiography, 500-page book, she was in the White House that night, one-third of a sentence. Louis Freeh, the FBI director, not a word. George Tenet, assistant director of CIA at the time, became head of CIA, not a word. George Stephanopoulos, who claimed to be in the Situation Room that night, not a word. It just disappeared from public view. Dick Morris, who considered it one of the three acts of terror in the terror summer of 1996, not a word. I was on a radio show once with Dick Morris, and he was obviously a bigger name than I, so I was trying to be polite. And there was he and I and the host. And I said, Dick, tell me what happened to TWA Flight 800. You knew. You were there. And then he talked over my answer like he didn't hear me. And then I repeated it again. And then he answered again as though my words had not filtered into the air at all. He just talked about something else three times. And I said, he's obviously not going to talk about this one. So sometimes it's not there. And with the Ron Brown crash, this was what really changed my opinion on the whole thing. Because for a long time, I wrote two-thirds of the book into a book thinking it was just an accident. Stuff happens. The real giveaway was the fact that the U.S. Air Force did a 22 volume report. And I went to request it, this is in 2003, and I was the first one to ask for it. The New York Times had a guy on the plane who was killed, 35 people killed him in Dubrovnik, Croatia. They didn't bother asking for the report. I'm thinking, how could they not do this? So I emailed, it's Ramstein in Germany where it is, it's a paper, it's all in paper, it's no disc or anything. And I get a functionary, and she says, you know, it's going to cost X thousands of dollars, it's going to take months. I got a deadline, I have a summary. I said, well, I guess I'll live without it, because I just don't think I'm going to find anything there. And I said, sorry, it's a little rich for my blood, I got a deadline, blah, blah, blah. I get an email back from a colonel. He says, it'll be there in a week, we're waiving all fees. The Air Force obviously wanted the truth out. They had 6 people died and 16 cashiered as a result of this. And they weren't happy with the outcome. In fact, I got a call for the first time just 2 days ago from a retired Air Force colonel who knows a lot about this thing. And he told me, and this is a very credible guy. He said, what we did is, you know, if a plane crashes into a hillside, he said, we dropped a special ops guy in immediately afterwards because Clinton had to ascertain that Ron Brown was dead. And then when you get back into the book, you'll see how this all figures in. They didn't care. And then I shared the technical data with a couple TWA captains who had gotten to know through the 800 investigation, and I let them have at it for a while. And they believed, they're firmly convinced the plane was sabotaged. There was this one, just curious detail, and I'll leave it here. I was working with a Croatian interpreter. What fascinated me about this is that Ron Brown was not, he died the day, on an April 3rd, so they pushed it back to April 4th, so it was like, tied his death in with Martin Luther King's, you know, blah, 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 you know. Well, he wasn't going there for some, as they said, some mission for peace and justice, or whatever the Clinton said. He was going there to cut a deal between the neo-fascists who ran Croatia and a certain American corporation. It was much in the news in 2003. Enron, right? Enron guys took their own jet. And they landed at that airport. It was the worst storm in 10 years. Nonsense, it wasn't even raining. Before, just minutes before the Ron Brown plane did. And I'm into the Air Force report, and I come across this interview between the American ambassador to Croatia and an Air Force investigator. And he says, the ambassador says to her very pretty innocently, he goes, you know, the person you really need to talk to is Zdenka Gast, a woman named Zdenka Gast. And the Air Force guy says, why? He says, you know, because she was the liaison between Enron and the Brown Party. And she was supposed to be on the Brown plane. And at the last minute, she got off and got on the Enron plane, right? So this makes it a little bit suspicious. It's kind of interesting. So I immediately tried to call Zdenka Gast, because she lives in the United States. And I got right to her office. I left a message. You know, she's never going to call you back, but you got to try it. And the person said, I know she'll want to talk to you. No, she's not going to want to talk to you. Never call me back. But I'm going through the internet looking for stuff. And I find a photo of Zdenka Gast in the Yugoslavian, or the Croatian equivalent of People magazine. And in the photo is Zdenka Gast, big buxom redhead, nice looking lady, middle-aged lady. And under her right arm is Alexis Herman, the Secretary of Labor, who arranged, and then White House liaison, who arranged the fatal trip for Ron Brown. And under her left arm, Hillary Clinton. Oh. Right? This is after the plane crash, right? The three amigas. And so I immediately sent it off to my interpreter. I said, I figured this must be some huge fundraising event in which Zdenka managed to pull these two together and get a picture taken. Turns out it was Alexis Herman's wedding reception inside the White House hosted by the Clintons. There are about 30 people in attendance, and you've heard of the other 29. You know, and there was a dank of gas in the midst of them. So you find these things, and I cannot come to a fully conclusive verdict on what happened with Ron Brown, but the dispassionate observer, looking at the facts objectively, will come to the conclusion that he did not die by accident. And there's openings in that, you know, but and I've gotten so little help until just the other day this guy calls out of the blue. So you never know when it's going to happen. Yes, sir?
You mentioned that you think our military shot the plane down by mistake. Did they suspect it was another 9/11 type situation, or was it just a mistake, or what?
That's an awfully big question, and I if I were to answer that now, I would take, the rest of the hour. But I don't know the answer. Okay. I just be honest with you, I don't know.
Okay.
Yes. Randall?
Have anybody taken the job of tracking down every member of that crew and trying to interview them?
Of the ship
that the boat.
No, no, that's been, those people are so off limits. None of them. Mm. And any of the, we know there are three subs involved.
But people have tried to interview them and they've been told they can't?
Yeah, I mean, it's been, okay. And it's so verboten. It's astonishing. I heard just after the 800 investigation, the video came out this summer. For the first time, I heard from one of the guys on the subs. And he wasn't on the sub that night. He was on the sub a few days before, but he loaded, as he said, some experimental missiles on that he had never seen before. And then he said when he heard of the attack, of the thing, he was with his wife, and his wife said, do you think that was a terror attack? And he said, I hope to God it was, because if it wasn't, it was us. And now, I don't want to go into any too much detail, because I don't know the answers. You know, I really don't. And I'd like to know more, but up until then, I've always tried to be agnostic on the subject, because I don't know for 100% confidence that it wasn't a terrorist attack. It's just that the evidence, as much as I'd like to think it was a terrorist attack, just for the sake of you know, our own sense of confidence in our military, the evidence makes that very hard. Yes, ma'am.
I seem to remember, wasn't there a stewardess who survived the plane crash?
The Ron Brown plane crash, yes. Her name is Shelley Kelly. She was actually an Air Force officer, some warrant officer. She didn't survive long, and nor was she killed. She was in very, very bad shape when they took her off the plane, and they couldn't rescue her because actually a major storm did hit that night, some hours after the crash, and they had to carry her down the hillside, the Croatian search and rescue or whatever. I mean, there was a lot of rumors about her walking off, and that didn't happen. So then, just moving on a little bit, I just want to hit you with some other major stuff that's true.